Jim Giambalvo, Dean of the Foster School of Business, and it's my pleasure to welcome you to the Barbara and Harry Markowitz Lecture Series. This year marks the 100th anniversary of the Foster School, so it's wonderful that in this very special year, we can host a very special lecture series in honor of one of the great figures in modern finance theory, Harry Markowitz. The person who helped make this event a reality is Ron Leishing, the chairman of Mountain Pacific Group. Ron is a longtime friend of Barbara and Harry Markowitz, and his firm is the proud sponsor of the lecture series. Please join me in a warm welcome for Ron Leishing.
Jared and to Jim Volvo for making this wonderful facility available to honor our friends Barbara and Harry Markowitz. It's 65 years since he wrote his seminal thesis back in
1952. And if you think of it, it has transformed the entire world, basically, of finance. That this profession that we work in was founded by one single man. It's difficult when you look back. It's like being on top of Everest and you look down at the foothills and you say, oh, that's trivial, that's nothing. Climbing those first stages was an amazing, amazing accomplishment. You could look at mean variance modeling and say, oh, that's a second order Taylor-Maclaurin expansion. But if you think back, the very concept of utility theory was only invented in 1947. So this young man then, this genius, had this innovation, and this innovation meant that he also had to work on the mathematical side of it. So he's not only done innovations that we know about in finance, he also did other work in optimization itself. And so it's really a special honor for us to be able to dedicate these lectures to Harry and Barbara. As the song says, behind every great man, there's a great woman, and that's certainly the case for Harry. And he called me just before the lecture started and said thanks to you and thanks to the university for sponsoring this. So we've arranged to have many of his very old friends speak at these events, and they'll take place over the next year. And what we've also done is we've asked the friends to give the academic component, but then also other friends who've known him or known of him to talk about the practitioner use. So we're very fortunate first to have speaking a very old friend of Harry's, Marty Gruber. He basically needs no introduction. I mean, if you studied finance anywhere in the world, what textbook did you use? You use Marty's textbook. So he is a legend in that sense. He's written over 100 articles. But this profession is interesting because you don't just have the academic component, you also have the practitioner component. So he's been on the board of over 10 mutual funds and has looked very deeply at these questions. So Marty's chosen a topic which is very, very timely. You know, those of us who are active investment managers would hope we can add value. Sadly, his evidence points for most of us in the opposite direction. So he's going to be talking to us today about active versus passive management. Active management, you know, where you use judgment and expertise to try and find outperforming stocks. Passive, you buy the index. And that's a hard hurdle to beat. Very hard hurdle to beat, as he'll show. But he does find some hope for us. And then we'll draw on John Shervam. John Shervam very generously came today from Portland, where he runs about $90 billion of the Oregon State Treasury money, about $70 billion of which is in a pension fund. And pension funds in America are really, they have faced major problems. The return targets are virtually unachievable. 7.5% would be a typical one. And they have to do this by a combination of allocation and by manager selection. And now, if you go around the world, I mean, I've worked with funds in 19 different countries, funds ranging in size, small funds, maybe 30, 40 billion, large funds in excess of $1 trillion. All of them use Harry Markowitz's theory. It is amazing that one individual could have created such a transformation, created an industry, and frankly transformed the world. So it's truly an honor for us to be able to sponsor this, and in particular to invite our old friend Marty Gruber to give this first inaugural lecture. Thank you.
Microphone on?
Yeah, I'm going to be pacing after the beginning. Yeah, this is. Can you all hear me?
Oh, it's too bad. Harry, I understand you're going to be listening to this, and hello. You won't recognize the beard, but the rest of me is the same. I feel really both honored and humbled to be asked to give the first lecture in a series honoring Harry Markowitz and Barbara. As has already been stated, Harry created the world in which we work. I've been working with portfolio theory for more than 50 years. I was a doctoral student in 1963, when I discovered Harry's 59 book in the library. I was in search of a PhD topic, and that book acted as the basis of my PhD theses and almost all of the articles I've written since then. I met Harry soon after that through some of my published work, and we called and discussed some things. We continued to discuss research. When Harry started a mutual fund, became the manager of the Japan Equity Fund, he asked me to be one of the directors. I'm still continued to be a director. And my principal job was to translate Harry to the rest of the board. That was a really good time, because Harry and I would, and Barbara and my wife Ellie, would get together for dinner three or four times a year. And that was really a pleasure. I really value Harry for his contribution to the field of financial economics, for his role as a mentor to me, and most of all, for his continued friendship. Let me now turn to the subject at hand. We're going to be talking about active and passive management. And I think I'll have something to say for both sides of the issue today. I'm going to, rather than give my latest paper, which is on fund of funds, I thought what I'd do is go back over time and talk about what I've learned from all the research I've been doing on mutual funds, as well as the boards I'm on. If we think of the investment community today, we can really think of it as having two tracks. One track, which is active management, involves security analysts, valuation models, some risk forecasting. This all goes into forecasts of price or return. This gets churned into a portfolio optimization model. This is what Harry contributed, the portfolio optimization model, how we look at risk as well as return. There's another branch. The other branch really says prices contain everything we need to know about securities. Again, going back to Markowitz, let's get maximum diversification. Maximum diversification is to hold some sort of index fund. And so that branch would favor an index fund. How do we tell which is right? Down to portfolio evaluation. It all comes down to the fact that we have active portfolios, we have passive portfolios, and we have to figure out which is better. So the first thing we're going to talk about today is, on average, does passive management outperform active management? And I think we, most of us, know the answer to that in general is no. Passive management outperforms active management in general. But that's only part of the story. The other part of the story is the question, is anyone who buys active management pathological? And I'm going to argue they're not. And what I'm going to argue and show data on is the fact that there's actually some management ability out there. The question is, how do we capitalize on it? More specifically, if time allows, what I'm going to do today is first look at, can we identify a type of institution that on average outperforms index funds? And the answer to that is no. We're going to look primarily at mutual funds, but we'll also look at some private accounts. Why mutual funds? Because they're such an important industry, and because their data is so generally available, and it's good data. We're then going to ask, how well do a class of professional investors do in selecting mutual funds? And this includes pension funds, target date funds, and fund of funds. We're then going to look at, is there persistence in mutual fund performance? Does past performance tell us anything about future performance? And I shouldn't get give away my secrets, but given that I'm sure there is persistence, is there any way we can capture that persistence to make an excess return? The last thing is, do funds follow performance? And the answer to that is yes. Funds do follow performance. And what happens to those flows? As opposed to looking at the stock of money, what happens if we look at the flow of money in and out of funds? How does that flow do? Well, getting started. If we're going to talk about performance, we have to start with a model of performance. We can't just look at returns because we know there's risk out there. The standard model was the capital asset pricing model. Do we perform? Do we have a return that is above the cap, what the capital asset pricing model says it should be, given the risk that we incur? So alpha is how much higher we are than the capital asset pricing model says we should be. It's a simpler way. The simpler explanation I like is, can we do better than the combination of the Standard & Poor's index and Treasury bills, given that that combination has the same risk as the money I'm running? This is the standard model. We have evidence, early evidence, on small samples from Bill Sharp, from Jack Trainer, from Mike Jensen, saying, no, mutual funds can't perform, outperform passive management. Then an article came along. I don't know what's doing that. An article came along in about 1987, written actually as a doctoral dissertation at the University of Chicago, not in the business school, but at the University of Chicago, proving that investors outperformed index funds. The mean alpha for all mutual funds in the study was claimed to be 61 basis points a year. Not only that, but the study showed that the more the mutual fund charged its customers, the better the investor did. It also showed if they put a load in front of it, the investor did even better. Well, this is the period in my life where I was doing a lot of consulting, and every time I walked into a client, this was the most widely read article on Wall Street I've ever seen. It was in the Journal of Political Economy, not exactly a popular journal. Out would come this article. And it bothered me, because I knew something had to be going wrong. And I talked to Gene Farmer about it, and Gene Farmer said, yeah, he didn't believe it either. And not only that, but he had Ippolito's data. He didn't have time to work with it, but he'd ship it all off to me. And this is how I did my first mutual fund article. This is how I got started. And when I thought about it for a while, I realized two things. Ippolito had a lot of balanced funds in his sample, so they were 50 or 60% bonds. And he also had a lot of very small stock funds in his sample. And this was the period of the heyday of the small stock. So what I did was rerun that regression, not just with a market index, but with a small stock index and a bond index. And what we found is what you'd suspect, these funds were loaded on small stocks. Mutual funds hold stocks, most mutual funds hold stocks that are on average smaller than the stocks in the S&P index. And they tend to hold the largest stocks in the S&P index in less than market weights. So when you make that adjustment and you run this multi-index model, you find that everything's normal. You get the negative, you get the negative alpha, as you'd expect. You find that funds that charge more don't do as well for their clients. And when they put in a load, they do even worse. Now, what was going on with the expense stuff? Well, what was going on in the expense stuff is pretty, it's fairly obvious if you think about it. The small stock funds charge higher expenses than large stock funds? Well, it's not a trick question. Someone in the industry has to know the answer to that. Yeah, they do. So if you look at whether small stocks are doing great, if you look at expenses, you find that funds that charge large expenses are doing well. And that accounted for his results. Well, this got me to thinking about the process in general. And since then, what we've done is we've decided, the profession generally at large has decided that you have to use a multi-index model. a model that captures the major influences that affect returns. If you want to think of it as a multiple regression, where instead of just a market index, you have lots of different indexes in there, that's fine. Bill Sharp and I were working on this at the same time. We talked to each other about it because we didn't want to think, we wanted to stay friends. And Bill's the guy that did title, I wish I'd thought of the term, I didn't. Bill coined the term return-based style analysis. We both published articles at the same time, slightly different methodology, but basically doing return-based style analysis. Now, what return-based style analysis do, the option should be a set of indexes. Now, in my recent work, I use, instead of using indexes, I use exchange-traded funds on the right-hand side of the equation. That really reflects what you can do, because what I'm looking for is what an investor can do. And so what I do, and then we can, if we do that, we can think of alpha as how much better did we do than predicted by the APT model, or the interpretation I like, which is how much better did we do than a weighted average of a set of indexes that has the same risk as my fund. So we're going to be talking about alpha a lot. And that's what I mean by alpha. How much better did I do than a set of index funds that I could have done by buying a set of index funds with the same risk? You can also ask questions if you see any along the way. Now, I did two studies, an early one in 86 and a later one in 99, and still later one we'll look at in a few minutes in 2009. It turns out it's a good news, bad news story. It's a bad news story for the industry because, let's just look at the latest study, the numbers are close. Bad news study for the industry because the alpha is negative. Mutual funds, on average, don't do better than a set of index funds with the same risk. It's a good news story because if you add back expenses, they actually made choices worth 52 basis points a year. So they had management skills. They could make choices worth 52 basis points a year. The problem is they charged 118 basis points to do that. So this says the investors lost, but it also says management has skills. So that's at least part of that is good news. What we're going to look at is whether we can exploit that skill. I also want to alert you to something, because there are a lot of articles now pointing this out in different ways and using it to, quote, make money, but it doesn't make money. We also ran this with the single index model where we used the prospectus benchmark declared by the mutual fund prospectus. We have 2,000 mutual funds. They use 50 different benchmarks. The Standard & Poor's 500 index was used more than half the time. What we find is that if we do that, they actually show up with an alpha of plus 25 basis points. This is similar to what Ippolito did. They show up with an alpha of plus 25 basis points because they're smart enough to choose indexes that are weighted in their favor. They tend to hold smaller stocks and more value-oriented stock than the index they choose. For example, I found three small stock funds that called themselves small stock funds and chose the S&P index as their benchmark, which is exactly what I would do if I were in the industry. So you can consider this not good management, but good benchmark selection. I don't know why it keeps doing that. I must be hitting something wrong. Okay. A lot of people have done this with mutual funds. We kind of know what's going on. But I wanted to look at something else, another population, to see if this was data mining. And we managed to get 2,629 private investment accounts. It's a big sample of private investment accounts. The minimum investment in these accounts was $100,000. And when we did this and analyzed this, we found very similar performance. We found negative alpha, just like we did in mutual funds, but they performed a little better than mutual funds. And all I can do is, well, I think I know why, but I didn't investigate each of these sources individually. Probably the biggest one is they charge lower expense ratios. If we looked at the expense ratios on these private accounts, it was lower than a matched set of mutual funds. They had less turnover, which also helps. They're certainly subject to less regulation, and they tend to be smaller in size. So all of those may have contributed to the performance, but despite that, they still have negative alphas. They still underperformed on average index funds. So the next question to ask is, if mutual funds are doing this in general, can professional investors select mutual funds to get a positive alpha? Because they're professionals, we're amateurs. So we then looked at three types of funds. 401k plans, the 401k plans offer their customers funds that on average outperform index funds. And we also did it for my paper I just finished 10 days ago, is on fund-of-funds. We said fund-of-funds, they go out and they buy funds mostly in their own fund family. They should have inside information. Can they get positive alpha? We also did it for target date funds, but I'll just discuss the fund-of-funds. The results are similar. So let's look at the alpha column. This is how does the funds in 401k plans compare, each one in an average compared to a matched set of index funds. What we find is, again, they have negative alphas. They've added value, though. How do we know they added value? I'm now going to introduce a new measure, which I think I used for the first time, which I call differential alpha. Differential alpha is how does the alpha you earned on your funds compared to the alpha you would have earned if you selected funds at random. So for each fund we select, a 401k administrator selects, we measure the alpha, then we say, let's look at funds of roughly the same size in the same Morningstar category. If they'd selected theirs, what would the alpha be? Think of that as random selection. And what we find is that 401k plan administrators earn negative alpha, 32 basis points a year. But if we look at it compared to randomly selecting mutual funds of the same type, they actually showed ability again. We keep seeing evidence of ability. They had a differential alpha of 51 basis points a year. That's pretty hefty. And if we do a little further and look at how much of that is due to the fact that they can negotiate better fees, that about half of that was due to the fact that they had lower fees, but half of it was due to management ability. So we're seeing evidence of management ability again. Okay. I just said all that. Okay, now let's look at fund-of-funds. We have data on 1,612 fund-of-funds. These are funds that hold mutual funds. They could be target rate funds, they could be balanced funds, but they're holding mutual funds. The period was 2002 to 2015. They owned 11% of the assets in mutual funds. So this is a fairly important sector of the economy. You'd expect them to do well because of access to inside information. You know, and mutual fund managers talk to each other. If I'm a Fidelity fund of funds, I get to talk to a lot of the Fidelity fund managers, whether it's over a beer or it's in a fund meeting. So I should have access to inside information that helps. But what's working against that? What's working against that is fund family goals, and I'll talk about what those are in a minute, and manager goals. Well, the bottom line is that they produce negative alphas. But we can do something even better than that, because fund of funds are two types. They can be fund of funds that are offered by large fund families and take all or the vast majority of their holdings from within that fund family, or they can be fund of funds that are managed by an outside agency and hold no funds within the group that's managing them. When you do that, what you find is the inside fund of funds that are holding almost exclusively funds within the sample, they actually do 28 basis points per year worse than a matched set of funds. And the outside funds actually do 17 basis points a year better. This difference of 45 basis points is statistically significant. And what's accounting for this? Well, if we look at the fund of funds that select a fund from within the own fund family and compare it to other funds within the fund family that have the same Morningstar category, we find that they tend to take funds that are younger than the average choices they could have made within the family, and this results in a negative differential alpha. They tend to take funds that are higher expenses than the average fund they could have taken within the family. This leads to higher expenses. They tend to take funds that are smaller than the funds within the family. This leads to negative differential alphas. They tend to take funds that are managed by the same manager. And this really hurts alpha. This is statistically significant. This is compared to other funds in the family in the category they could have taken. So I would argue that fund objectives and manager objectives, and we do in the paper, are more important than any access to inside information and react to and lead to negative results. Okay, so what do we see here? Neither 401k plan administrators, nor fund of funds, nor target date funds can select funds that earn a positive alpha on average. So on average, they're all doing badly, worse than index funds. But at least 401k plans and fund of funds which aren't subject to conflicting family goals show an ability to pick funds that are better than average. So the story we're seeing over and over again is there's a lot of evidence of management ability, but that ability is not great enough to overcome the costs. Now we're going to get to a key point, which is if there's management ability and the management doesn't kick off the next day, there should be some forecasting ability and past performance, despite what the prospectus says. Past performance should tell you something about future performance. And what we've done here, and you'll see more of this later, what we've done here is divide funds into 10 groups. Group one is the worst, 10% of the worst performing funds. Group 10 is the 10% of the best performing funds. Then we look at what happens the next year. Actually, we did it the next year, the next 2 years, the next 3 years. And what you find is very strong evidence of predictability. What you find is there's every study ever done finds strong predictability in the bad tail. If you're a bad fund manager, the chances are you're going to continue to be a bad fund manager. Look, I can tell you how to be a bad fund manager easily. Just charge enough. Takes care of the whole problem right there. There is some predictability in the upper end. This clicker is, my fingers are too big for the clicker. Okay. What you find is that in the top decile had an alpha of plus 156 basis points per year. That's really hefty. Now, one of my pet gripes is these studies that take the bottom tail and subtract it from the top tail and look at that as a measure of performance. Don't ever do that. Because you can't earn the negative performance on the bottom tail. You can't sell mutual funds short. So whenever you see those studies, it aggravates me because it's just wrong. You can't, no way you as an investor can take advantage of that, can do that. What you want to look at is can they predict in the upper tail, because that's all you care about. If I know a mutual fund is bad, there's nothing I can do about it. I can't short sell it, not like a stock. So we found very strong evidence of predictability, and in other studies I'm going to look at, I'll continue that. Why? Well, I have an explanation for this, and in all modesty, I like to call it Gruber's rule. If you buy General Motors, you're paying for the machinery, you're paying for the sales force, and you're paying for the management. That's all incorporated in price. If you buy a mutual fund, you buy that mutual fund, that net asset value, whether the manager is terrific or the manager is lousy. Sure, a bad manager will hurt you down the pike, but at the point you buy it, management isn't priced. And I think this leads to predictability, because even if I know a manager is good, it's not going to be in price. And I'm going to say more about that in a few minutes. So I formulated that in 1996, and about 2 years ago, I realized that there's Gruber's generalized rule. Gruber's generalized rule is that while the market for securities is almost efficient, the market for managers is very inefficient. Management market, it's a labor market. Look at any of the literature on labor markets. Labor markets are inefficient. Market for securities are either perfectly efficient or almost efficient, depending on which school you belong to. I like almost efficient. Now, the fact that I found some evidence in management ability and the fact that it persisted over time almost got me stoned by my academic colleagues. And so in 2004, Birkengreen wrote a theoretical article proving that you could not have persistence. These are theoretical arguments. Let me tell you what the theoretical arguments are, and then we'll look at some empirical data. They first of all said that management will capture all excess returns in terms of fees. Well, that's not true. If you look at mutual funds, it may be true in some boutique businesses, but in mutual funds, fees charge very, very slowly. In fact, we'll see evidence if funds are successful, they grow, and fees actually go down rather than go up. So that argument is, at least for mutual funds, is spurious. Their more sensible arguments are, if you're a good manager, you get in large amounts of cash flow. Cash flow follows performance. If you get in large amounts of cash flow, you're going to not be able to do as well for any one of three reasons. One is you either have to take bigger positions in the stocks you have, which means your transaction costs are going to go up because you're selling and buying bigger blocks, or you're going to have to start buying some investments you don't like as much as the ones you already held, or you're just going to have to hire a lot of managers and it's going to come unwieldy and management costs are going to go way up. That was their argument, and they said, these arguments will instantaneously do away with any predictability. In fact, I kind of agree a little bit with reason two up above, but the difference with Birkengreen is I think it takes anywhere from 2 to 5 years for that to affect things. So there's plenty of time to exploit predictability. I'm also going to argue, and the next slide, we're going to look at evidence, because they argued all about growing and you have all these problems that grow. Size does not destroy predictability. Everything we look at says size doesn't destroy predictability. And this is a condensation of a long, complicated table. And I didn't do all 10 deciles because it's just too much to stare at. But here is, again, remember what we're doing. We're ranking stocks in one period, mutual funds in one period, and then looking at how those mutual funds do in the next period. Again, I use 10 deciles. First of all, note that the bottom half of mutual funds in terms of total net assets, the top half of mutual funds in terms of total net assets, and the top 25% of mutual funds in terms of total net assets. So Burke and Green would argue that the performance should be going down for the larger funds. We do this in cross-sectional and time series. And in fact, we found that the larger funds actually have better performance than the smaller funds. We also find that there's tremendous predictability. And the predictability, look at decile one versus decile two. The predictability continues. Oh, the correlation across the 10 things go from 0.96 to 0.94 to 0.93. Who cares? I mean, that's such a small change, it just doesn't matter. So there is predictability, and this doesn't destroy predictability. Okay, for those of you that don't like deciles, some people say it's unfair to look at deciles. Here's a regression. So here's what we do, is we take returns next period and regress it against a whole bunch of things, including, when I say returns, I mean alphas. Alpha next period, cross-sectionally across all the funds, regressed against the alpha in the previous period. And what we see is, how am I doing on time, by the way? Good, okay. What we find is that, let's look at the one-year results. What we find is the past, what I call ranking error, which is the last period's alpha. The last, first of all, 24%. I can explain, what is that? 21%. 21% of the difference in alpha across mutual funds in the future. That's pretty good. What we find is the biggest, and looking at 1 year, the biggest, look at the T values, the biggest influence is past year's alpha. Past year's alpha is a huge predictor of this year's alpha. Cash flow, they were right. Cash flow has a negative effect. When more cash flow comes in, the alpha is lower. But it's a very small negative effect. It doesn't nearly compare with that. The log of TNA size is not statistically significant. It's a minute effect. The things that are important are expense ratios and turnover ratios. So the three things that allow us to predict future performance are really cash flow, expense ratios, and turnover ratios. And we get good prediction. Now what happens if we go out 3 years? We did it for 1, 2, and 3 years. So now we're predicting 3 years ahead. So the alpha 3 years ahead, how is that predicted by the past? And we find just what you'd expect. The R square goes down. I mean, we're explaining instead of 21%, we're explaining 12% of the difference in returns, alphas 3 years out. That's still pretty good. The past alpha is still very important, even 3 years out, statistically significant, plus the way you'd want it to be. Cash flow remains about the same in importance. Log TNA doesn't mean anything. Expense ratios and turnover ratios become even more important because they're kind of permanent over time. Returns are subject to random shocks. Expense ratios and turnovers tend to change very slowly. So the longer out you go, the more predictive power they have. The interesting thing is family size becomes important. As you go out longer periods of time, Family size when you go out 1 year doesn't matter. When you go out 3 years, does. I can only hazard a guess as to why. And my guess is that funds that do well tend to get more management resources poured into them by the family. Big families have more resources to put in the funds that are doing well. So family size tend to have an effect over longer horizons, but not over short horizons. Still not nearly as important as these other influences. Okay, so I'm going to skip this because I really said that. But let me do just the conclusion so far. I believe we showed that there's a strong relationship between past and future alphas. The best performing funds in the past tend to have positive alphas in the future. For those of you that are active management, all you have to do is say, I'm the best performing fund, and everything will be fine. Not as important as people say it would be. Growth does erode performance, but it erodes it very, very slowly. It's not nearly as important as return. Why doesn't performance and predictability disappear for large funds? Well, I can only speculate. We know expense ratios go down with larger funds. The fund flow due to success does tend to hurt performance a little bit. Large funds seem to be able to gain better analysts and continue to do well. Also, having studied this for different time periods, we find that the half-life, Burke and Green said that good managers would disappear within a matter of days. And that, you know, that's just not going to happen. You're not going to raise expenses in a matter of days. Enough cash or flow isn't going to come in to destroy you in a matter of days. We find that the half-life of a good manager is somewhere between 2 and 3 years. Meaning within 2 to 3 years, half of them disappear, and half of them are still going on. So that's more than a reasonable period of time. Okay. Let's look at cash flow. Now, I'm going to do this quickly because there are dozens of articles that have followed this documenting return-chasing behavior. This is about the strongest relationship I've ever seen in finance. This is again, we group mutual funds into 10 deciles by performance, by alpha. And then we look at what happens to cash flow the next year. So we're not double counting. Here's return. We rank them by return, and then we look at what happens to their cash flows the next year. And again, you see, consistent with the story, you see, I've never seen a correlation coefficient of 1 in economics before in my life. It's the third time I've ever seen a perfect fit. The bottom decile, on average, loses 15% of their capital in the next year, and the best decile gains almost 30% of their capital. So there's strong return-chasing behavior, strong alpha-chasing behavior. And this is found so many times in so many different studies. I may have been first, but I'm not last. So what does this all mean? Now, I think it means the following. We know that mutual fund holders as a group have negative alphas. We also know that there's some forecasting ability in past alphas. We also know that investors chase fast past alphas. So you could expect that cash flow, which is chasing past alpha, which predicts future alpha, could have a positive alpha. Let's follow that. That's a winding road. We're saying that future alphas predict, past alphas produce future alphas. Not perfectly, but with some relevance. We know that the investor chases this alpha. If it predicts future alpha, we'd expect this cash flow to earn a positive alpha. And what we actually find in the study is that if we look at a one-year holding period, because we're dealing with cash flow, we can't say you buy it and you hold it forever. So we're talking about a one-year holding period. We find that the positive cash flows, every quarter, we take all the cash that comes into mutual funds and we buy those, we act like we're buying those mutual funds with it. So we're putting together a portfolio of mutual funds every quarter, only with the new cash that comes in, and we assume that's held for a one-year period. Okay? Timing clear? We're not double counting because we have the data. And what we found is that the cash flow actually has a positive alpha of almost roughly 29 basis points a year. And the cash outflow saves 29 basis points by getting the heck out of there. That's a positive number, but it's what you save by leaving the fund. So the cash flows in and out of funds, unlike the stock, seems to be doing well. Well, what's going on? Now I'm in the realm of, that's just different periods. I'm going to argue that all of this occurs because of different clienteles. Why does the stock not do well and the flows do well? I'd like to argue that there's a sophisticated clientele that follows mutual funds, moves the money around, tries to pick the best funds, and is somewhat successful at it. There's a disadvantaged clientele. There's a tax disadvantaged clientele. When they sell and buy, they're going to have to pay taxes. They don't want to pay taxes. There's an institutionally disadvantaged investors. They're given a set of mutual funds, and they can't go out that set. And then there's my favorite group, which I used to call the mentally disadvantaged investors, but I got in trouble. So I changed it to the unsophisticated investors. They just buy the high expense mutual funds that their friendly neighborhood broker tells them to buy, and they hold on to them. And that's consistent with this story. Let me recap the whole lecture and what I want you to get out of it, if you get anything out of it. And I'm going to, rather than put my back to you, I'm going to read it off the sheet. I can't find any class of investors, mutual funds, pension funds, individual accounts that earn positive alpha. Yet I find many classes of investors who outperform random selection. So they're showing management ability. They're showing an ability to actually analyze securities. They're just not showing enough ability to overcome costs. Management has ability, and that ability is not priced in the market. Past performance is somewhat predictive of future performance. Actually, bad past performance is very predictive of bad future performance. Good past performance does give us information about future performance. The best mutual funds, on average, earn positive future alphas over a significant but limited time span. So to start with my second slide, an investor who puts some of his money in active management is not necessarily pathological. But he does face an added risk. And the added risk is that he picked the wrong manager. And so it comes down to, like most thing in finance, a risk-return trade-off. You can get a small increase in expected alpha if you buy managers that have done well in the past. But that comes with an added risk. And are you willing to take that added risk to get 20 basis points a year? Only you can answer that. Okay. Do you want to do questions now or later?
Hi, I'm John Shervin. Thanks for having me. I want to start by soliciting your sympathy because I drew the short straw of following Professor Marty Gruber. Thanks for that, Ron. So I've been in this business a long time. I was, you know, Chicago MBA, and boy, that's like three quarters of an MBA right there. So that was terrific. Thank you so much, Professor. Second thing I want to do is give a shout out of the utmost respect to Mr. Markowitz, whose enormously powerful contribution made such an enormously powerful contribution to the empirical tradition. And, you know, I've been a beneficiary of that tradition. That tradition has shaped really the trajectory and all the contours of my professional career. So this is a real treat for me. And then the other thing that occurred to me is it would be far more interesting for you all if I was up here to say, yeah, that's great, Professor Gruber, but in the real world, it actually works like this. And you would think I would be the right guy for that position. Why would you think I would be the right guy to essentially argue the other side? Well, because I'm recently remarried. And I got to tell you, getting remarried at middle age is the ultimate expression of hope over experience. And yet, despite that credential, I'm not going to argue the other side, because I've got 25 years of experience that corroborates each and every data points that Professor Gruber took us through. And so my experience, I started as a portfolio manager. I spent a decade running a race against the S&P 500, and then lost a series of bets and became a chief investment officer. And those responsibilities included managing portfolio managers, being their supervisor, as well as hiring and firing external managers. And I had that experience in a wealth management context. I've had that experience in an institutional context. And the story doesn't change. It's pretty much exactly like Professor Gruber laid it out. And so I think the most important thing I can say, perhaps my best contribution this afternoon, is to come back to the question is why? Why does it keep happening? Why does it persist? And, you know, maybe we can get at that in a little bit. I think it's important, at least it is for me in my experience, it's important to differentiate between public markets and private markets. The so-called debate in public markets is no debate. There's just not a shred of evidence that active management is value add on a triple net basis with any persistence. The evidence in private markets is better. Although even that is starting to deteriorate. So private market returns, private equity, as an example, the persistence of private market, private equity returns after the great financial crisis has really started to break down. But there's still some pretty strong evidence. So if you discharge your duties as a fiduciary, as I have my entire career, you need to have something to hang your hat on. And for me, that's been the empirical tradition, which you've seen here. And when you apply that empirical tradition in public markets, it's a pretty short story. And in private markets, it's a better story, but it's getting more difficult. So, again, why? Why? I graduated from business school in 1991, and that was the year that Fama French came out as a working paper, and we pretty much thought, well, that's the end. That's the end. You know, once the results of Fama French were published, he pretty much said, and it was published officially, I think, in 1992. But once those results came out, you pretty much said, well, that's the final nail in the coffin. And here we are 25 years later, and people are still plowing money into active management. And so you come back to the question, why? Why does this persist? And I don't know the answer. Everywhere I've been, where I've had a supervisory role and I've had a fiduciary responsibility, I employ empirical techniques to get beyond the narrative. And when you do that, again, it becomes a pretty short story. But there's obviously a lot of investors and a lot of investment mandates where there are different rules or different governance practices. And we could also say this is another hypothesis as I have, is this is really testament to the strength of the marketing machine. A marketing machine that is able to really obfuscate what are now empirical truths, which is impressive on the one hand that it's that powerful, but depressing on the other hand, because what's the value add for society? Governance is also a big contributor, that you have people in positions of governance that haven't had this type of empirical training, and they're pulled into their roles for acumen in other areas, even other areas of business, but haven't had exposure to the empirical work that Professor Gruber took us all through. That's kind of the best case scenario of a governance vulnerability. There's plenty of worst case stories about governance vulnerabilities where the trustees get entertained socially, and that becomes the basis of decisions. And I promise you, index managers are not the ones doing the entertaining. And then there's, you know, the humanity of it all. The fact that we, as humans, have these biases and these vulnerabilities that Kahneman and Tversky and Thaler have taken us through. And the fact that as much as we've progressed in some areas, our humanity is very stubborn and very, very persistent, and we keep falling for the same tricks. So those are just a couple of things I think about, but it's extraordinary for me to be here 25 years after I had a moment where I thought, well, that's the end of active management. And I'm sure it's bigger than it was 25 years ago. And yet we've now got a quarter more century of data that demonstrates, you know, the fact that it's really not effective, especially triple net. So that's really the conclusion of my remarks. I'm hoping that we get some questions to elaborate on some of these points.
Let me, before we start, thank you very much. I'd like to try to answer part of the question you raised, which is why active management still exists. By the way, passive management is growing at tremendous rates, but if you look at the numbers, the assets under active management are still growing. They're not shrinking. There's all this disaster that index funds are going to take over the world. The amount of money under active management, the last set of numbers I looked at, which were recent. But why? I have an unusual prospectus on this, because I started talking about index funds in 1968. And I remember when J.P. Morgan hired a very bright technical guy from MIT, an almost PhD, whose whole job was to prove that index funds were a tool of the devil.
Mm-hmm.
And think about it. If you're managing money, do you want to get paid 135 basis points for managing an active portfolio, or at Bankers Trust, we managed index funds for 3 basis points. Do you want to make 135 basis points or 3 basis points? In dealing with treasures of companies, do you want to have a nerd at a computer running your index fund, or do you want to have a staff of people from various firms who are taking you out to play golf and buy lunch? This is the practical end of the business. If you're a treasurer and you have to report to the board, do you want to say, the market went down, there's nothing I could do about it? Or do you want to have 10 different positions, one of which have probably gone up, and you can explain why you're a great manager because that one went up? So all of these behavioral things answer in part the very excellent question you raised.
Economists would call those agency issues. Yes. And they are so real and so big. And so what I would say to the students out there is, to Professor Gruber's point, you're going to get offers to go work in active management at pretty nice compensation packages. And so just be prepared to deal with the conflict, especially if you get put in a fiduciary position. Right? You can get lucky on the timing and have good entry and post good numbers for a good part of your career, and it could all entirely be luck, right? You just got lucky. And it won't be until the fullness of time that some geek like me shows up and does a three-factor regression to expose the fact that all you did was do a value tilt or a small cap tilt. So I guess emotionally you just got to be prepared to compartmentalize, to deal with the dissonance.
Questions? Yeah, Ron.
To make a case for a case.
Are you collecting all your gold? You have a nice beach house. I don't know what.
I should make a case at least for our existence. Let me ask you a couple of questions, if I may. First is, you seem to find such negative alpha, it's even beyond transaction costs, beyond market impact. Is that not the case, or
that's,
is it just
that's
all
not the case? What I'm finding is that there's management ability that is, in other words, if transaction costs are 135 basis points, management has a negative alpha of minus 65. That's after they paid all those costs. So if they did it for free for you, you'd get 50 basis points. Or if they did it for 30 basis points, you'd get 20 basis points. The thing is, the fees, the good news I'm finding here is management ability.
Yes.
The bad news I'm finding out is by the time they charge you for it, it's gone. So the my tendency would be to believe that there was no evidence of management ability, and yet every one of the cases I talked about today, there's evidence of management ability. But you have to prove to me that that management ability can overcome what you're asking me to pay for it.
And so you're saying we're paid too much.
Well, in the mutual fund industry, you read now, the mutual fund industry, to help people out, is going to lower their fees. What they're doing is trying to stop all the money from going to index funds. And if they lowered their fees enough, they'd be competitive with index funds. But index funds fees are, for institutions, are just incredibly low.
I remember the paper by Harry where he shows that the cap-weighted index can't really be an efficient portfolio because the corner portfolios bring in and drop out securities. Would you agree with that? And if so, doesn't that leave hope for some form of active management where at least we can outperform the index at low risk, albeit modestly?
I don't sweep active management away. What I'm saying is what I really believe. I mean, I have some money in active management. Not all of it, most of it's in index funds. But I honestly believe that it's up to the active manager to offer the proof. At one time I was on some boards, and I was head of the equity committee for 60 mutual funds. And I had to invest in them because I was a board member. I believed, and even after I saw the empirical evidence, that I could find three of those managers that had positive alphas. But I had the advantage of looking at their past. I had the advantage of having them report to me every month or every quarter on exactly what they were doing and why they were doing it. And I had long histories with them. So do I think we're going to go more and more to passive management? Yes. And I think certainly, I'm on the board of a foundation. There are four of us that manage their money. We're 100% indexed. I don't want to take a chance with their money. It's long-term money. I'm not going to take a chance with it. But in my own, in an individual portfolio, do I have some active management? Yeah. Because it's fun. Yeah. You have to talk louder, I can't hear.
Sorry, got a mic now. Okay. My question is about whether or not if you looked at different asset classes, you might get different results, or is your first line there, no class of investors, does that incorporate, say, small cap or international or some of the areas that most investors would say are not as efficient?
I've looked at, nobody has looked at all that. You never can prove that markets are efficient because you'd have to look at, it's a very good question. You'd have to look at every conceivable asset class that was out there. I've looked at major asset classes. I've broken down the mutual funds and the large stocks, small stocks, medium stocks. I've looked at a lot of international stocks. I've looked at bonds. And all of those have negative alphas to different degrees. And partially when you look at international stocks, there's a little more information in management, but they're also higher fees. I think the equilibrium between active and passive management is going to come eventually in two ways. One is there'll be so much passive management that there are really things to discover out there. And more importantly, active managers are going to bring their fees down. And they're going to have to justify performance fees. What I didn't have time to talk about in my research, one of my favorite articles is on mutual funds that charge performance fees. There are actually mutual funds out there that charge performance fees instead of a flat fee. So that what they get is a function of how well they perform. And believe it or not, those funds do better than funds that don't charge performance fees. They're motivated, and when they do bad, the fees are bad. So this is a business. When I have a public trust, I agree totally what was said. I do nothing but indexing when I have a public trust. When I'm doing my own money, or I was dealing with a public entity that was willing to take risk. It's all about whether you're willing to take the risk of an active manager. We find the top groups that actually have positive alpha, but you can pick the wrong one in that top group, and then you're in trouble. Yes? No.
Where do you think that equilibrium is between active and passive management? Because active managers do serve a useful function of price discovery. If all you had is passive, the index provider decides what company.
Yeah, I agree with that totally. I think there's an equilibrium. I don't know. I can't tell you whether it's 30%, 40%, 50%. The complete ignorance guess is 50%, so I'll say 50%. I mean, I don't know, but there'll be more payoff. As we get more and more passive management, there should be more of a payoff from active management because there are less people doing it. It's like as the newspapers cut back because they don't get more as much advertising revenue, we're getting less real journalism in the newspapers. As you cut back, the advantage to being a really creative active manager should increase. The question is, it's not that I really believe these people exist. The difficulty is finding them. The difficulty is being able to spot them. Of course, it's kind of like mining low-yield gold. There's a lot of noise going on, covering up the numbers. The component due to random shocks in the stock market are so big compared to what you can bring to it that it's going to wash out your performance, and you really have to have an excellent track record to demonstrate it. And I think if you ask me what the Chicago School really invented this stuff, and what if you ask me what they contributed more than anything else, it was a healthy air of skepticism. It was show me you can do it, and you're worth what you're doing. That's different than saying you can't possibly do it. Okay, yes. I'm sorry, I pump adrenaline. So
in many of your slides, you've referenced the time frame between 2002 to 2015. How have you adjusted for externalities? For example, U.S. equity market prices have been supported by Fed policy. How do you normalize that regression?
Well, I don't, because the regressions are purposely run through periods. If you look at the periods we're running them through, there's a lot of sinusoidal movement. And so it's not straight up, it's not straight down. If you're asking me if I did the same study 40 years from now, if I get the same results, I don't know. There's my favorite story that I love to tell is about Garrel Eupenian was the place kicker for a very, very famous place kicker for the Miami Dolphins. He was better than anybody else that's ever played the game, and he was 5'6" tall. He was on a radio program. Somebody called up and said, could you kick the football further if you were taller? And he said, I never tried it when I was taller. So I don't know. It may be different 30 years ago. I'm betting it's not, because I've been careful in the data to make sure that I went through not just periods of boom and periods of bust, but where I went across different periods. Russell, I'm always afraid when you ask a question. Go right ahead.
Marty, yeah. So the question from the institutional investors really pertains to the public versus private market breakdown. You have folks like David Swensen, you know, who's sort of a poster child for being able to invest in effectively in the private market managers effectively. But I think probably across the institutional investor landscape, that's sort of been, over the last 20 years, has been a real benefit for us. And when we look at the dispersion of returns in places like venture capital funds, the successful plans might have a 2,000 basis point advantage persistently over the poor performer plans. So Yale would have, you know, in the last 10 years, I think an IRR of over 25%, whereas other institutional investors without, you know, as good of a selection capability might be averaging 5%. Describe a little bit of this public market versus private market dichotomy.
Well, let's assume I believe markets are totally efficient. I don't, but let's assume for the moment I do. I know people that make really good returns, and a lot of them are in the venture capital business, and a lot of them are supplying equity where it can't be supplied, and they're getting an economic rent on the equity they're supplying. Other ones are actually going in. My first consulting job was for a company that went in and took ownership share of a company and managed it till it was good and then sold it, and they did really a great job. So there are different resources. I'm really talking about public money here. I'm talking about the public capital markets. I can think of a lot of reasons. I just mentioned two. You earn a rent on capital. If you loan money to someone that can't get it from the capital markets, you're entitled to a rent. And even an efficient market economist would say you should get it. If you go in and you bring a management element to it, you can earn an excess return. I'm sure there are other reasons I haven't thought of, but those are at least two. I'm on an endowment, and we just sold index funds, and we do pretty well without going to these other sources. So I'm not saying they can't work, but if I had to make a gamble, I'd gamble more on someone that was supplying a scarce resource than somebody that was buying something in a market.
I was just going to add that I think Mr. Swensen does everybody a great service in his book. He basically says, don't try this at home. Because it's an access issue. So we can find them, we actually know who they are, but we can't get access to them. And then even if you've got a powerful investment brand like Oregon that gets you access, what does $50 million in a venture capital fund do for me in a $90 billion program? It gives me, you know, bragging rights that I'm in, you know, some you know, household tech names, but it doesn't even come close to moving the needle in terms of performance.
Yeah, that's a good point.
With the technology, surely this means that the search for alpha will get ever harder due to increased market efficiency. So, John, does that mean that it's all now down to you and your asset allocation calls and your search for the new frontier? How do you, you talked about the, it's a super tanker you're running, and as you said, 50 million is below a rounding error for you. So it has to be your asset allocation moves and maybe some new frontiers. Is that what it's down to?
Yes, but, and the but is, how much different is asset allocation than trying to find skill in active management, right? So we profess no skill in tactical asset allocation. And so the asset allocation, in my opinion, should largely be driven by what your liabilities look like, what your governance structure will allow, good, bad, or indifferent. So I don't see a lot of opportunity for adding value vis-a-vis asset allocation. Not in a, like, application of skill translation into alpha sense.
I had a question for John on the this idea of maybe hidden costs of indexing, if you believe it, and sort of what you do about it. You know, maybe I'll posit sort of the Russell 2000, if you were passive against that. It has an annual rebalance. People can sort of predict what's going to enter and exit. There tends to be costs that are associated around just selling everything on sort of June 30th. Maybe another would be the MSCI Emerging Markets Index, where there was all this angst around whether the A shares in China were going to be added or not, and there was a lot of market moves based upon that decision. How does one sort of think about those costs, if you think those exist, and sort of guard your portfolio around it?
Thank you for that question, because it enables me to brag a little bit. Because those are real costs. And so oftentimes people say, well, sure, if you don't believe in the application of skill in public markets, why don't you index the entire Oregon portfolio, especially when you, Shervin, can get index essentially for free? Because we can get it for free with securities lending arrangements, or we can pay whatever, a quarter of a basis point. And so the answer is those are costs, and so for us, it creates an opportunity where we insource those mandates, manage them ourselves, and we trade around the reconstitution effects. And in a great year, we'll add 5 to 6 basis points in a large cap mandate, and we'll add 20 basis points in a Russell 2000 mandate by doing nothing more than trading around the reconstitution events. But, you know, 5 basis points on, you know, billion-dollar mandates is real money. You know, it pays for my expense account. So, you know, 20 basis points in a Russell 2000 index. I mean, this is real money. And so that creates for us to be, you know, you have to be a big investor and have the systems and have people that have experience. But once you do, those events, those costs create real opportunities for us.
I found the results on the funds of funds providing skill interesting. I was wondering if you could say a bit more about this and try and help us understand. Are they just doing obvious things like ruling out sort of the dogs? Like, what percentage of the bottom tails are they avoiding
the funds. That's like the other thing I consider. That's a new paper. I literally just finished it a week ago. And what we really are looking at, you're a fund of funds. Are the funds you pick better than random selection? Then are the funds you pick from within your fund family better than random selection? And finally, do the funds you pick from within your fund family better than other funds you could pick within your fund family? What we find is that when they pick funds, they tend to load up on funds that are advantageous for the fund family. What we expected to find that would be largely balanced by the fact that they have information. You know, I've been on a bunch of mutual fund boards. Mutual fund managers listen to the same economists. they're not theoretically, it's not against the law to share information, but they share information at lunchroom, they change information at the bar when we go out drinking after meetings. So they have, should have, the ability to pick the best funds. That's what I expected to find when I wrote the article. When I looked at the data, I didn't find that. I found, in fact, they were doing worse than they should do. And when we found out, when we look at why, it's obvious. What they're doing is helping the fund families start new funds. They're buying the funds where the management fees are more expensive. They're often buying their own, the other funds they manage to increase their own management fees on the funds. And that's that surprised me. Why am I still doing research? I'm still doing research because there are questions I want to know the answer to. And that's one of the cases where I start out believing strongly I was going to find one thing and finding exactly the opposite. I don't know if that answered your question.
I think I must have misspoken. I think I meant to get your 401k.
Oh, I'm sorry. I thought you said fund of funds.
Yeah, I said fund of funds.
Okay. You meant
the other one where you find
the okay. So 401ks, in one sense, the 401k guys are doing a good job. I mean, they're doing 50 basis points better than if they just went out and bought funds. It takes a lot of ability to turn alpha positive.
I mean, Oh,
I don't know. That's a very good question, and I'll go back to my place kicker. I just don't know the answer to it. It's an excellent question. I wish I'd thought of it when I wrote the paper. I didn't really examine why they were doing this. I did find, and I didn't talk about it in the slide, in that paper, I do find, again, some forecasting ability. 401k managers that tend to do well in one period tend to do well in successive periods. So there is, again, management ability that carries over. But I don't know why they're not doing better than they're doing. Or why they're doing why they're not doing worse than they're doing, because I didn't really look at that. Okay.
Well, one last question, if I may. With the disillusionment with active management, which you've documented so clearly, there is this huge move into so-called smart beta strategies, like buying a value index or buying low volatility index. As Elroy Dimson and Bill Sharpe pointed out, these strategies are macro inconsistent. In other words, not everyone can buy low-priced-to-book stocks and outperform. There has to be another losing group. Therefore, these will have periods of strong outperformance and underperformance. Do you see a risk that now that you've unmasked the weakness of active management, that we're going to endogenize instability as people race after new solutions?
Well, I was hoping somebody would ask me that question, as a matter of fact. Let me back up and do sort of the forerunner of it. The forerunner of it is we have all this stuff on smart betas. And first of all, there's no such thing as a smart beta. They were just smart people that figured out how to use betas, okay? What happens is we know over time, small stocks have higher returns than large stocks. That's been a persistent influence. So let's talk about factor investing. Now, let's assume I'm a pension fund. If I'm a pension fund, and I don't care about as much about short-term movements, I want to put more money in small stocks. In fact, on one endowment I'm in, that's what we do. I mean, because we don't need the money for a long period of time. And that's macro consistent because we're just willing to bear that risk. We're taking stocks that the normal investor feels is risky. We're buying them. We're getting a reward for that. The normal investor is fine taking a few basis points less to avoid that risk. So there are certain factors. Now, separate out factor investing is I think these factors are mispriced and I can take advantage of them in the long run, which is perfectly consistent in my mind with efficient markets and consistent with macro consistency. What I can't do is figure out that I'm going to buy small stocks today and large stocks tomorrow. Now I'm back in active management, and I don't know how to do that. Maybe somebody does, but I don't. But the use of these factors is very good, and something which I've used in industry, not just in my research. the other thing you see are these new, quote, index funds. We ran one of the first equally weighted index fund at Bankers Trust way back, way back when. And we didn't really understand where a lot of this stuff worked until we got factor investing. All you're doing is if you take these strategies, you're buying somebody else's factor allocation. And rather than do that, I'd go into the factors one at a time by themselves and not take somebody's bundle. Is that close enough to? I sort of changed. If you don't know exactly how to answer the question, you change the question enough. But did I get close enough to what you were asking?
Yes, thank you.
So I would just add, because we have big positions in factor strategies, and I would just add that you really need to have a governance structure that will support it, right? Because the average factor will underperform just a little bit longer than the average tenure of the CIO.
Yeah.
You know, that's the way that's going to work.
Yeah.
And so you need to have a governance structure, meaning a board that understands the empirical support Good. For that approach and has the patience to ride it out.
What?
Go ahead.
One of my favorite examples I got from a very smart MBA student when I was teaching one day, and I was talking about risk and standard deviations and beta. He's a portfolio manager. He said, no, you don't understand risk. Risk is the probability that I'll lose my job sometime in the next 2 years.
Yeah, it's these agency issues that are everywhere. I want to say one more thing about cost, because I was being facetious earlier, but our long-only public equity program, round numbers, is $40 billion. So either through the combination of reducing active fees or insourcing mandates to take advantage of our competitive advantage of trading around reconstitution effects, if we save a couple of basis points, that's $8 million. That pays for my entire staff, and then some, all my systems. I mean, you know, these are big, big numbers. And so that's why these issues of cost and performance is so critically important, especially when you're in a fiduciary role.
Well, I'd like to thank Marty and John for doing this first lecture in honor of Harry Markowitz. It's a special privilege to be doing it here at the University of Washington. The University of Washington, for those of you who don't know, was rated, the finance department or the business school, was rated number 7 globally by the Financial Times, number 7. So not only do we have an amazing facility here at the University of Washington, we also have very special people who come here to honor Harry Markowitz. And thank you for your time. And thank you, John and Marty.
Thank you. John, thank you. Nice meeting you.
That's fine.